Hello, my name is Richard Serrett, and I am the host of About Town, the program that takes us to new and fascinating places here in Ventura County. And today we are quite a place to go to, the Fillmore Train Museum, which is hosting our Steampunk Festival. The STEAM Festival gets its name from that educational term STEM, which is science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. But they've added a little flair to it. They've added the A for arts. So it's science, technology, engineering, arts, and mathematics. And it focuses on early science fiction and 19th century technology embodied by the steam engine. And what better place to have a festival of steam than here at the Fillmore and Western Train Museum in beautiful Fillmore, California. When we get back, we'll be actually visiting the STEAM Festival here at the beautiful Fillmore at Western Antique Train Museum. We'll be right back. We're very lucky to have the producer of our STEAM Festival right here, which your real name is?
Gerald Ridenour. But yes, they do call me Poplock Holmes. I am Tamer of the Wild Beats, here to keep you safe.
Oh, great. Now, tell us a little about the festival and what are your goals?
A little? Well, it's much too big to say just a little bit about it. You see, we've combined steampunk, steam trains, and steam curriculum as taught in schools nowadays, which is science, technology, engineering, art, and math, to create the trifecta of steam, because it takes triple the penetration to get anywhere anymore, right? So we're trying really hard to trick people into getting smarter.
I think that's a great goal. Can you tell us a little bit about the inspiration for the STEAM Festival?
Well, the inspiration came from going to a lot of steampunk events where people just weren't doing the way I felt it needed to be done. I wanted to give a little bit more. I wanted to be educational. I wanted to be inspiring. I wanted to be something that you took away and it changed your life a little bit. I want to hopefully touch that little special spot that you go, oh, that's where I wanted to be hit. And so not only do we got the music, but we've got the vendors spread out around. We have our art show. We have a scavenger hunt. We have some really amazing art displays. And just trying to hopefully inspire people enough that when they get inspired and they have that inspiration inside them, that they act on it. Because inspiration doesn't mean anything unless you act on it.
That's true. And that's what we certainly need is imagination and the arts to help us really define, you know, what technology is all about.
Exactly. And the beautiful thing about steampunk is it really is science, technology, engineering, and math realized through an artistic medium. So if you get over and take a look at one of our sculptures, Satellite 2012 by Greg Fleischman, the man has engineered an artistic sculpture that is all based and derived from mathematical computations of triangles that you extract from not only squares but cubes. And he's got a lost triangle theory that is a triangle extrapolated from corner to corner of a cube in three-dimensional space where the square root of the base is 2 times the length of the height. And all of his sculptures basically flat pack into a box about yay tall and 5 adult humans could get on top of it once it's constructed and jump around, and you wouldn't, it has no flex whatsoever.
That sounds great, fantastic. And you have with us a steam engine to make things even better.
Now that is really what drew me to Fillmore, is the trains. Not only do they have a real 1868 train, they also have the train from the Lone Ranger movie, and they also have the train from the Westworld TV series. We weren't supposed to really advertise that, but I'm not involved, so sorry.
Yeah, but the steam trains, they're a Hollywood steam company, and a lot of TV shows, commercials utilize these trains, and by doing so, they've managed to preserve these rolling museum pieces.
Exactly. They say this is Hollywood's train station. This is where they come to store them, to find them, to take them into Hollywood, because it's really the closest place that you can archive this kind of history. And not only have that, but the people who know how to bring them out of archival, who know how to fire them up. Because if you fire the boiler on a steam train wrong, you'll throw the bearing and you'll destroy the train.
It's an art right there. They had the best technology of the 19th century right here at the museum.
Absolutely. Some of these trains have ran for over 100 years.
And they're still going.
Still going without a rebuild. The gravel crusher is quite interesting to watch it running on steam. The little puff of smoke every now and then. And every now and then it breaks and you see the crew get together, their oil cans and work it. It's like, that's part of it, is bringing it back to life.
That's exactly, and that's what it has to be done, to make these things not just in a book, not a picture, even a video. This is the real way it was 100-150 years ago.
Exactly, and as humans, we all learn through visceral, tactile, hands-on experience.
Mechanical gears and pulleys and things like that. This is a unique piece of art. What exactly is it?
Well, this is a time washing machine. You see, everybody has a time machine, but time machines are so passe. So I created a time washing machine, and I figure, well, people launder money, so why don't we wash time? Because time is money. Time is money, right?
Yeah, of course.
So we're going to wash our time here. Would you like to see how it works?
Yes, I would like to see how.
Right over here. Twist the machine. Twist the knob here. Oh, yeah, you want.
Washed. What is it done?
Wash time. That's how much time we just spent. Yeah. Keep in mind, though, this is completely theoretical and untested. I don't really know that this was your time. This could be anybody's time.
That could be anyone's.
Exactly. So, since time is money and people launder money, then I might be able to wash time. It makes sense in theory, right? So this is the time washing machine.
I'm glad you could demonstrate it for us. Now we have clean time.
Exactly, because that's the one thing we need to do most is clean up this time.
All I can say is we're having a great time here at the Steam Festival.
Well, I hope that that's great clean time. Until next time.
There he goes. Got all the time in the world. Okay, we have a unique exhibit here at the Steam Festival. It is an old vehicle of some kind. What exactly do you have here?
This is a Model T Ford, which is comprised of about six different year Model Ts. The oldest parts we can find are from about a 1915 Model T, and the newest parts are about a 1926. Way back in the day, a gentleman needed a truck on his farm and put this together, so everything here is original Model T parts, just spanning about a decade's worth of Model Ts. She's mechanically 100% sound.
Oh, really? You could take this on the road?
Yes, we could if we had better tires. That's the only problem. We have never had this engine open, and it has its original head gasket from the factory, so this engine has never been opened since the time it left the factory. In 1926. The motor is a 26. You can completely disconnect from the battery if you wanted to.
Whoa! No battery, and it still works. I notice it's got a dumpster part on the back end of it. What's that all about?
This particular truck was a dump truck, and what Model Ts had is most of them had what were called gravity dumps. There's no hydraulic mechanism, there's no mechanical mechanism to help it dump. You pull the latch and you need to make sure that you loaded it correctly, and it just, by gravity, it's offset enough to where when you pull the latch, it dumps the load, falls back down, you go get another load, same thing, and over and over.
It looks very efficient, oddly enough.
It was a very good system. If you had your load in there correctly, not too far forward, she would dump every single time. Nice, quick, and efficient.
Great. Well, your name again, sir?
My name is Travis Durst.
And you're from?
San Diego, California.
And what organization do you belong to?
We belong to the Antique Gas and Steam Engine Museum in Vista, California.
Thank you very much.
You are very welcome. Thank you.
We couldn't possibly show you everything here at the Steam Festival in downtown Fillmore. They have a collection of old cars. This is a Model T Ford runabout. This is a kind of sports car of its day, if you will. And as you can see, it's quite stripped down. You may have noticed many people wearing goggles. Well, they needed them because the cars had no windshields, and so you needed to keep the bugs out of your eyes. But wouldn't it be great to ride around in something like that. This is an antique steam engine that's been brought back to life. This was brought back to life by the same people we were just talking to, the antique steam and gas engines. And it's all been fixed up. This is one cylinder using steam. It actually turns this wheel, which belts could be attached to operate threshing and a variety of farming tools and equipment, from saws to, whatever they actually needed. But this was what made America great in the 19th century. We're lucky to have with us the owner of the Fillmore Western Historic Trains. And so, your name, please?
I'm Dave. This is your Teresa.
I'm Teresa.
Teresa, good to you're having a great event today. Tell us, what got you interested in owning a railroad?
Well, I think I was in the wrong place at the wrong time with the wrong answer. Other than that, it's been fun. So. It's had its challenges. This is a new event for us, and we're really trying to stretch it and make it go, and I think it will in the next couple of years become a pretty good-sized county event. And we're excited to have steampunks here. And as you can see, Teresa is, I can't speak for her, but I'll say she's dressed in the steampunk stuff. And
you're dressed for the occasion. What has been the most fun about running a railroad?
Meeting people, keeping history alive for generations to come.
And that's what's really needed. We need more of this, especially in our age as we stumble into the future, and so much is being lost due to, just being sidetracked. But today, we have places like yours that keep the past alive.
Yes, and we have people that come on board with us that do keep it alive. They want to learn the steam locomotives. They want to learn old-time railroading. And so we've been very fortunate getting some very good employees. Everyone has it in their hearts out here. And that's been the really fun part of running the railroad. The other thing is Teresa and I have always kept it as a family event. We have Christmas season coming up, which will have thousands of people, thousands of small kids and families coming out and enjoying the railroad. That's real fun in running it.
Well, I'm glad you're keeping this alive. I want people to come, my viewers, to come out and ride the train. Do you have to have reservations?
Most of them you do. On our weekend scenics, you can just do walk-up, but most of them we do recommend reservations, and some of them are reservation only, like the North Pole Express. We do comedy murder mysteries for adults. We do family murder mysteries. We've got, like, the steam rides today, the North Pole Express. We have dinner with Santa, so they have dinner on the train with Santa. We do all kinds of fun things to do. Yeah.
It sounds like great fun. I urge everyone to take advantage of this unique opportunity we have right here in Ventura County. Thanks for letting us interview you and attend this amazing event.
Well, thanks for coming out, Richard. It's good to see you, and I know that you've been a historian in Ventura County for years, and we really appreciate you and what you do.
Well, thank you very much. We'll be right back on About Town. The brakeman of our steam engine here. Your name, please?
Ken.
And how long have you been working with steam engines?
Oh, my. On and off since I was a little kid. I ran a little small one that you sit on.
Oh, that sounds like great fun. Now, can you tell us a little bit about this steam engine here?
The engineer and the fireman would be the one to talk about, but it was built in 1913, and it was a logging engine, I believe. And we restored it in the last, I forget exactly the date we restored it.
I hear it's been used on a lot of movies and TV shows.
It has, yes.
What can people expect if they take a ride on your train today?
Oh, a lot of fun and a lot of noise. That engine makes a really nice barking sound when it comes up the hill with a lot of steam, and the whistles is beautiful.
It's great to see such a great turnout here at the STEAM Festival. What do you think?
Oh, yeah, it's great. I love to have all these different people out here to ride our train and enjoy themselves.
All right. Well, if people want to come down here on a day when they don't have a STEAM Festival, do they have to get reservations ahead of time?
It's recommended to get reservations ahead of time, but we have an office. You can just come down, buy tickets, and hop on the train. And we have a murder mystery dinner train. We've got some North Pole Express trains coming up. And it's a great time for the kids and the whole family.
Well, thank you very much for talking with us here at the Fillmore West Railroad Museum. This is an oil burner and not a wood burning steam engine. The wood burning ones have those big, large smokestacks for the ashes won't be shot out and perhaps start a fire. But of course, they didn't need to do that with coal or later oil. Remarkable point. The first oil-powered steam engine in the world ran from Santa Paula to Ventura. Anyway, how long have you been involved in being the conductor of the railroad?
Well, this railroad, 3 years of the Southern Pacific 42.
Oh, you have experience all over the place.
Well, not all over the place, but in the L.A. area. Yeah, I used to work Southern Pacific freight trains from L.A. to Yuma, L.A. to San Luis Obispo, L.A. to Bakersfield. And a lot of locals.
But not steam, of course.
Oh, no, not steam. No, no, all diesel. Oh, this is a 1913 Baldwin locomotive steam locomotive. It's a 280.
What does that mean?
280. It has two driving wheels in the front, and or two pilot wheels in the front. It has eight drivers underneath the boiler.
But
that makes it go.
It just uses oil and water. And
this here is an oil-fired locomotive, and it also runs on water. That's right there, that's water that's leaking out of the locomotive.
That, of course, is to make steam, right?
A lot of that is condensation.
How fast will this train go?
Well, this locomotive here, it'd probably go about 60 miles an hour.
That's really fast.
Yeah, on our railroad, though, on this line, we can only do 15. Yeah.
Well, that's probably safer.
It's a lot safer, especially on these tracks.
Why are they so in love with steam, though?
Take a look at this. This is great. This is something you don't see anymore. Trains were pulled by these steam locomotives for 100 years or better. And back in the 50s, they all disappeared. They all ended up in parks or in roundhouses just rotting away. And luckily, there's been people who've been able to rescue these. Like our owner of this railroad, Dave Wilkinson, and his wife, Teresa. They saved this locomotive.
And they've restored it back to working condition.
Right back to working condition. It's wonderful. It's wonderful.
Well, thank you very much for speaking with us. Many happy miles on your restored train.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Hopefully we will have many happy miles.
Thank you. I hope people will come and take the opportunity to ride on these historic pieces of machinery. Welcome back to the program, and as we promised, we're speaking with Dr. Solar. Thank
you. How you doing?
We're doing fine today. Tell us, how did you get involved in being Dr. Solar?
Well, the first solar panels in America were sold in 1978, and I bought mine in 1980, and I went off grid for 20 years, so I'm basically a solar pioneer.
Oh, that sounds great. Yeah, you were managed to...
In the mid-80s, I was still one of only 50 solar homes in America.
Well, that's amazing.
We've come a long way.
But what you're at today, what do you talk about as Dr. Solar?
Well, I present the fact that solar panels, solar photovoltaics was discovered in the 1860s. And I give a little bit of the history of what's held us back and why we haven't progressed so far. And then we have some magic tricks and things that... talk about the history of energy and such, and the solar-powered airplane, things like that, yeah.
So, but it was actually that early in the 1860s?
1860s, yeah. So steampunk, you know, I mean, 1870s to 1920s is totally my realm to have a medicine show, because that's when they prevailed.
Now, you don't actually sell medicine, do you? What do you sell?
Well, I try and sell the concept of a nuclear-free future is what I try to sell, yeah.
Sounds like a great concept. What do you see the future as becoming?
You know, I mean, United States is lagging in solar power to other places of the world. The sad fact is that they were invented right here. You know, the first cells were invented in Southern California in 1954. Whoa. And I was lucky enough to see those in 1954 when Bell Laboratories came to our school and put a little cell on the back of a little model race car, shined a light on it, rolled across the stage, and they said, "This is our future." And I'd waited 25 years for that future to come when I bought those solar panels and went off grid.
Maybe you're doing your best to help bring that about.
I've been doing my shows every day, I'd say one show at a time, to reduce the carbon footprint.
It sounds like you're really bringing the solar future to America now. So, but your main message is that we should change our environmental technology into a solar one.
Right. There's no reason that solar power can't fuel America's electrical needs, especially now that they've reduced manufacturing to a pittance of what it used to be, you know. So, you know, not to get political, but George Bush, when he was leaving, outlawed incandescent lights because of their heat they put out and that they use more electricity than the twisty little fluorescents. Truth of the matter was, mercury had been recently taken out of latex paint, and so he found old Herb at the mercury place was now able to sell more fluorescent bulbs with mercury in them.
That sounds like not really a very good exchange.
No, but they didn't know that LEDs were right around the corner. So we've been able to reduce electrical consumption by over 80% of every light bulb that's out there in LED form. So our electrical demand is a lot less than what it was before. So that's why the closure of these nuclear power plants and such is just apropos, because we don't have the electrical need. So,
that's great to hear. I notice on the wall you have a museum of oddities or strange things. Could you show us some?
Sure. As Dr. Solar, a lot of people have asked if I'm a real doctor, so I thought I'd bring some of my medical appliances where I gained my knowledge over the years. It's right over here at the world's first solar-powered oddities museum.
All right, let's check it out. This is amazing. What in the world do we have here? I'll let you explain it for us.
Well, like I say, this book up in the corner here is from 1842. 1842, that's when Abraham Lincoln probably sat on the corner of his bed and said, "I think I'm going to run to be president." Who would have known that 18 years later he'd finally be elected, right? That's a study of phrenology, which is a study of the lumps and the bumps on the human skull that determine your personality, whether you're outgoing, whether you're lazy, whether you're creative. Like if you had a bump right here, they'd say you had a good sense of color. Slightly to the rear, they'd say you had a good sense of time. Now, I got into this because when I was young, I looked in the mirror and I saw this.
Oh.
It just kind of drew me in, you know?
I could see why. What does that bump on your head mean?
I think it's in the realm of creativity. That's what I've been told, anyway. Yeah.
So, all have bumps like that, I think.
Okay. When was the last time you had your head checked?
I don't know. Maybe you should check it.
Ah, yes. All right. Well, maybe we could put one on there. Bonk. When's the last time you saw one of these?
Oh, well, I went to my doctor's office and they hit me in the knee with one.
Yeah, well, they don't need this anymore. Now all they have to do is mention vaccines and they get a knee-jerk reaction from either side.
These what do we have here?
Frogs are kicking back playing dominoes right now. They're hoping they're going to play their favorite music later, but I don't think so. You know what that is?
What?
Hip-hop.
Oh.
They love hip-hop. Oh, yeah.
What else do we have here?
Well, Friday night I offer free tooth extraction. Well, pain-free tooth extraction. Here's a vial of some of the teeth that I've taken. You won't see any gold in those. I've already cashed those in.
Oh. His unique presentation about solar power, magic, and medicine. His is a recreation of the old medicine shows of long ago.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray.
Come on, come on, my friends, Dr. Solar, the Midnight Sunshine Family Medicine Show is about to begin right here on the stage of the world's first solar power theater. Bringing you wonders of the world, lights of which you've never seen before, such as... Thank you. Oh, wow, check it out, check it out. You do have people here. Of course I do. Don't drop me. I won't. Don't drop me. Now, it's a lovely audience, isn't it? It certainly is. But what are they doing here? They've come down for the Steam Festival. I know, but what are they doing here? They've come here to be entertained. Really? Yeah. When are you going to start? I have started. Huh? No, now we're going to have a math test. A what? A math test. Oh, come on, it's Sunday. It doesn't matter. If you're going to travel with a good doctor, you have to know about mathematics. Oh, great. Now, what would you have if you found 10 cents in your right pocket? 10 cents? Yeah. Whoopsie-doo. Stay with me. You found 10 cents in your right pocket. Yeah. You found 5 cents in your left pocket. Is that a wooden nickel? Wooden nickel, metal nickel, it doesn't matter. You want a bet? America started with wooden coins and it very well may end up with it. And think how far ahead you'll be with your allowance. Oh, great. What's the matter? You ever think it might be a relative? The wooden nickel might be your relative? Yeah. How come? Came from a very old family tree. I'd like to have an assistant come up and help me if they would. You want to help? Come on up. Give a big hand. Yes. Hey, do you know the difference between a pizza and a magician? Generally, a pizza has little problem feeding a family of three. You're in big luck, though. You're going to earn big bucks. I have a sack of shredded money I found in a dumpster bin behind the U.S. Mint Department. All you have to do is puzzle these back together in hopes of getting the largest half of a bill with the serial number. Look what it says. I earned big bucks, the magician assisting Dr. Solar. Spend a few days putting that back together. If you get, say, a $50, $100, $1,000 bill, nothing cheap about me, is there, folks? Paige, don't listen to them. Rush down the bank and cash in for the real thing. Put that in your pocket. No, come on. You got things to do. You got to earn that money now. Can you wiggle your fingers like a magician? Point them at the balloon and yell, hocus pocus. Maybe a little louder. Perhaps you need a costume. You ever heard that saying that a magician's merely an actor playing the part of a magician? Let me see what I have for you here. Okay, put your hand in there. Put your hand in over here. Ladies and gentlemen, girls and boys, I present to you Miss Fooling You. Can you get it to your left hand? Put the right hand on top, and we bow to the audience. Perfect, perfect. Beautiful. Once more with feeling. Hit one more time. Wait a minute. You wanted hair? I'll give you hair. Is that enough hair for you, huh? Is that enough hair for you? I think so. Dr. Solar's Good Time Sunshine Traveling Medicine Show. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you, thank you. A big hand for Miss Fooling You here. Keep in mind, this may be the world's first solar-powered theater, but you are my sunshine.
We've had a great time at the STEAM Festival here at beautiful downtown Fillmore at the Fillmore Western Rail Museum. It's been a great time because we've learned so much how STEAM helped to stimulate our modern world. If you want to know more about this organization, contact them at thesteamfestival.com. And if you want to know more about me and what we're going to be doing, contact my website at richardserrett.com. And we'll be seeing you as we examine more of the unique and the special things about Ventura County. Thank you. Until next time.